You're tuned to WEOS Geneva, WXXE Fenner Syracuse, W201CD Ithaca Community Radio at 88.1 FM, or Free Radio Santa Cruz.
To the rich man's bright lodges, I ride in this wind. On my good horse I call you, my shiny black bears. To the playhouse of fortune, to take the bright silver and gold you have taken from somebody else.
A war zone is euphemistically called a theater. But war itself is now being presented as a sort of theatrical spectacle for the majority of the American population, who will not be anywhere near it. The approach to war, actually the entire for public consumption presentation of U.S. governance, looks more and more like a cliche Hollywood production. The tough-talking politicians standing up for freedom. The waving flags, the smiling soldiers. This is no accident. The entire presidential spectacle is tightly scripted and closely managed by teams of professionals. And the news media, which should be pulling aside the veil to expose the lies and manipulation, is actively a part of creating the illusion. The dismembered limbs and smell of burning flesh in faraway lands will not reach us via our TV screens. Thus, the angry, twisted men who return from military service to become snipers, murderers, or demented street people will not be understood for what they are. People who snap after being turned into killing machines, participating in atrocities that they can never put out of their minds. All for a patriotic fantasy that they realize is a big lie, only after it's too late. Tonight we continue our exploration of the crafting and telling of that big lie. First, part 3 of the Radio Netherlands series on propaganda, with a look at the role of war reporting. Then some information on the public relations campaigns used to manipulate public sentiment towards Iraq. We'll conclude with a talk by Dr. Michael Parenti titled Rambo and the Swarthy Hordes on the use of the entertainment media to influence American political perceptions. This is on Welcome Guests. I'm Lynn Gary.
And we, the democracies of this world,
we will use whatever means are necessary to achieve our objective.
Radio Netherlands presents The Theater, War Correspondents on the Frontline, Part 3 of the Sound Fountain series, War of Words. The program was produced and presented by Michelle Ernsting.
Correspondents are our eyes and ears on the front lines. A breed apart, they pay a high price to gather the news we all crave in times of war. Many dodge bullets, roadblocks, and other obstacles to get to a story. But to what extent does their battlefront coverage clarify or cloud our understanding of conflict? Today in the theater, from London, Alan Davis of the Institute for War and Peace Reporting. Also from London, Peter Noorlander, campaigner for free speech with Article 19. From Amsterdam, Sees Hamelink, professor of international communications. From New York, Steve Rendall, of fairness and accuracy in reporting. From wherever the story takes him, Robert Fisk, investigative journalist. And from Geneva, the founder of Peace Studies, Johan Galtung.
I think what is typical of war journalism is that the focus in a conflict is on the violence, the fighting. And if it is organized fighting, we call it a war. And of course, the basic focus is who is winning and who is losing. So it's a question of capability, strength, or motivation, and things of that kind. It's a very military way of thinking. But on top of that, it has been shown that quite a number of war correspondents actually were sports correspondents in their youth. And you can say that that's another expression of the same basic idea. You have two teams or two persons, and they are lined up against each other, and the question is who wins. Now here are rules, of course, so it's a question of respecting the rule, but it's also a question of capability, strength and motivation. In other words, exactly the same kind of basic thinking. Problem is that we are dealing with something more important and more difficult than a soccer game.
We have to go to Baghdad, Secretary. We're going to Bernard Shaw in Baghdad.
Something is happening outside. The skies over Baghdad have been illuminated. We're seeing bright flashes going off all over the sky. We have not heard any jet planes yet, Peter.
No plane. Now the sirens are sounding for the first time. The Iraqis have informed us.
Well, we heard Peter Arnett saying the Iraqis have informed us, and then we didn't hear anymore. This is probably just a technical glitch. They have four wires that they can use. And those.
The biggest problem for journalists in conflict situations is getting killed. Working with local journalists, you have a bigger problem still, and that is actually, if you're an international journalist, you always have the luxury of a plane ticket and passport back out of the country. If you're a local journalist trying to cover a local, i.e. your own war, or a war with a neighbouring state, then you can't actually leave. So you have to be very careful about your movements, about who you speak to, about the repercussions or impact of what you do, because there's no, you know, leaving the war zone or the battle front for you. And it's a problem.
Well, you find very few real good investigative reporters around the world, and it's not for lack of aspiration or ambition in the profession. But I think there's basically two reasons. I mean, it's expensive for many media to have people whom you can tell you just take a year, and you really go into this story, really work on this. You get, you know, behind the facts. You really expose what's happening. And secondly, of course, we talk about conflictual situations in which it has become increasingly dangerous for journalists to function. I mean, every year a large number of journalists get killed. And they don't just get killed because they happen to step on a landmine. They get killed deliberately. I mean, this is a new development in conflicts. That wasn't the case, say, 10, 15 years ago. Journalists have become targets. It's become a very dangerous profession. So that means you can only go into a conflict when you have an enormous level of protection, when you have armored vehicles and you have very heavily armed bodyguards. That was the way in which CNN could function in Mogadishu at the end of the Operation Restoration Hope. And all the other agencies had to leave Mogadishu because it simply was too dangerous. So, because you can't pay the life insurance policies.
I mean, the corporate side are better financed. They have better logistical support. They have better insurance. They have better hardware, better vehicles. A freelancer independent, you know, has to rely on lifts and what have you. It's not a good situation at all.
Much of the reporting during the war on the Balkan, I mean, when the shooting, for example, in Sarajevo, was covered by freelancers who took enormous risks. But that, you know, that raises another moral issue. Can you do that? Can you afford to send young freelancers who take enormous risks into very dangerous situations because you want to have a news story?
I've always taken the view that if you're frightened of writing a story and you can't write it, there's not much point in risking the danger, so you should fly home and get out. So I've always taken the view that if you're going to be committed to the story, you can't bear that in mind. By and large, I've found that most people in the region, they may not like what you write, but they will not feel hostile towards you unless they think that what you wrote was written with ill intentions. They don't mind you making mistakes. They don't like it, but they can accept it. And they will accept that you're being very critical and hurting them in words if they think you're honest. But if they think you're being malevolent, they will then conclude that you're doing this on somebody else's behalf, and then there's a whole range of ideas which will occur to them. If you're doing it on someone else's behalf, why? Are you being paid? Are you a spy? Are you working for a government? So it's essential for the people here to realise, if a journalist is here, and in my case, of course, I'm talking about me, that you're on the level, you're a journalist, and your only intention is to get at the truth as you see it, as a human being, you will make mistakes, but you, as long as they don't think that it's done with ill intent, I think you can say just about anything you want, and you should say just about anything you want.
It's very difficult to be a lone voice in the media. If you are an independent journalist and you are actually arguing or reporting against the grain, as some do, then it's very difficult, one, to make impact or to have your story or information believed. It's usually sort of ridiculed or simply dismissed. The problem with Afghanistan, as I think quite a few people have put recently, is it's been a very difficult war to cover for the journalists because of various reasons, one reason being, you know, the Taliban, or certainly Al-Qaeda, had bounties on journalists going in there. Another reason is this new tradition that the British and the Americans especially have introduced since the Gulf War, which is saying that everything in this neck of the woods is a restricted zone. You must actually join the media pool, and in joining the media pool, say for Afghanistan, may actually mean sitting on a warship in the Arabian Sea, which means actually you don't get anywhere near the theatre of conflict. I mean, the lesson was learnt in Vietnam when the American general said, we made a mistake in Vietnam allowing journalists access to all areas they wanted to see. The general consensus was the Vietnam War was lost in the TV screens back in America.
Montana 8, this is 2-4. I guess you've been monitoring, but we've got that movement again out there where the Illum's going in.
How forceful has the government been in trying to keep the media in line? Well, that's a good question, because if you go back to the Gulf War, where the United States only allowed U.S. reporters to report, to have what they called a pool system of reporting, they wouldn't allow most U.S. reporters into Iraq or in any of the battlefield areas during the Gulf War. They only allow one reporter to go on this mission and one to go on that, and then that reporter would come back, and all of the different news agencies would use that one reporter's reporting. Now, those Defense Department press restrictions that happened during the Gulf War are continuing today.
There's much more media management of a theater of war. The American military has been very good at this. The British government has been very good at this. But also, if you are an American journalist, or even maybe an international journalist, I think the American forces think it's within their right to actually arrest you or detain you until such times as they think they can release you.
I think if you talk about journalism, if you focus down on, say, investigative journalism, it's definitely getting much more difficult for investigative journalists to have access to material. And it is important in investigative journalism to have access to a wide range of material. Just to get good stories, you need material and you need information. And you need it either formally or you need it informally. You know, a lot of investigative journalists often have their sources, you know, anonymous sources, say, etc., etc. Now, these sources have become less willing to release information in a lot of cases. Then there is also an important issue where the state is restricting its freedom of information laws, or is applying its freedom of information laws much more strictly and is refusing to release certain information that it deems is going to be harmful to national security.
So you take maybe the world's best journalist, Robert Fisk, for The Independent. I don't think he will go anywhere the government opens a gate for him. He'll be crawling under a fence, which he literally did, in order to go to other places. And that's what a good journalist does. I think a good journalist has two characteristics. He's very knowledgeable. In other words, he can see the conflict both in space and time. He can see the manipulators behind the conflict arena, maybe one or two oceans away, and he can trace it in time. But in addition to that, he's a detective. That means he's looking, trying to find the hidden traces and trying to find the sources of those traces, those footsteps. He does that in a masterly way, Robert Fisk. So it's a question of training journalists in that direction. The investigative journalist makes the world transparent. The, let us say, ordinary journalist is just reflecting what the government wants him to reflect.
Officials say these smart bombs can accurately pinpoint enemy hideouts.
Israel says curfews and restrictive measures are needed to prevent Palestinian attacks on Israelis. Military spokesmen report heavy collateral damage in and around the enemy compound.
The terminology of language in war reporting has actually changed and taken on Pentagon military-esque type terminology, collateral damage being a case in point. I mean, collateral damage actually is an American military euphemism for deaths. And basically, we hear too many journalists using it. Governments, when they're waging war, will actually try very much their damnedest to actually get their message across. And they will use euphemistic words because they don't want members of the public to actually get the reality of what happens when there's a war, i.e. when a smart bomb turns out to be not so smart and kills 100 Afghan villagers, then collateral damage spoken in Washington doesn't then disturb too many people. It doesn't then disturb the war effort.
The style of reporting that we've inherited from the past, particularly that which came through from World War II, has become extremely dated, extremely cliché-ridden. This is partly because of the injection of a massive amount of American reporters who have largely come into Europe and the Middle East without sufficient background knowledge of the history and the culture and the society. It also comes from American television. My bugbear would always be CNN. The fact that an American television audience, rightly or wrongly, is only supposed to have between 17 and 40 seconds, or at the most 1.5 minutes concentration time. So everyone finds themselves sucked into this constant pressure of putting massive, complex, tragic events into such a short period of time that they use shorthand to do it. They begin to use clichés, they drop out the important historical nuances that must be understood if you're going to understand why people are killing each other. And the result is that, in a sense, most journalists find themselves writing in such a way that no serious reader would really be interested in reading it anymore. They use so many clichés, they condense things so much that it loses meaning. And in this way, because they use these constant clichés, language, which is meant to liberate you and make you give you greater expression, tends to restrict them. It becomes a prison for their work. And I think particularly in the days of television, there's no point any longer in writing journalists imitating news agencies and writing in the paper tomorrow morning what most people have seen live on television 12 to 18 hours earlier. We've got to get into writing with colour, analysis, investigation. We've got to get out there on our own, ignore what the news agencies are saying, ignore what the wires are saying. You know, I used to walk in for a drink in the evening in the Commodore Hotel, that famous, awful, dreadful hotel, which journalists now think they loved, over-expensive, disgracefully expensive hotel in Beirut, because I lived here, so I didn't have to live in the dreadful place. But I have a home here, but I would go in there in the evening and would find all these journalists hovering over the Reuters machine and the AP machine in the lobby, recycling this clichéd, condensed and therefore inaccurate material coming off, instead of saying, look, I don't care what the agencies say, I don't care what CNN says, and getting in the car and going to where something is happening and deciding for themselves what it is.
If a person with a camera was then actually to be on the ground and then actually take footage of what happened as a result of that smart bomb being not too smart and going through this house, then I think the shock of a footage like that would be tremendous. But part of the problem would that footage actually get shown on television? I don't think it would. Basically, everything is sanitized, and that's part of the problem. Simply that the news editors don't want to upset the viewers, so they take a conscious decision to knock it out. But in doing so, they sanitize war. We work with local journalists in conflict zones, and it seems strange to say, but the good thing is they haven't got some of the bad habits that Western media have. Local journalists on the ground do not usually use terms like collateral damage or what have you. And also, I think in Central Europe and other countries, Central Asia also, you will actually see raw footage of wars. I remember when being in Moscow, actually you saw some very nasty footage screened of the war in Chechnya. and that basically turned a lot of people's stomachs who saw it. But at the same time, it actually showed people in Moscow and elsewhere who was watching it the true nature of war. That's something that we don't have here in the UK, and that's something, sadly, they don't have in the States, because I think that would change a lot of people's opinions.
If you go to the battlefield, and if you think that's where the action is, that is definitely true. But maybe that is not the way you should approach it. Maybe you should go behind the battlefield. So, for instance, let us say you're interested in Yugoslavia. Basic forces behind what happened in Yugoslavia were in the Vatican, the European Union, United States, of course, Russia. And if I should focus on two countries and two capitals, I would say Vienna and Bonn, Berlin. Now, maybe that's where he should go, to try to find out what those people were looking for. And maybe that it is more important to find the people who are pulling the ropes than to look at the puppets who are dressed up in a uniform, killing each other because somebody else is pulling the ropes. So maybe this is simply because they go to the wrong place.
This is extraordinary. The lights are still on. All the street lights in downtown Baghdad are still on. But as you look, you see trails of flashes of light going up into the air, obviously anti-aircraft fire. We're getting seeming starbursts in the black sky.
The problem with frontline reporting is you get a small slice of the pie, a small slice of the picture. You actually see what's happening in that neck of the woods, but it doesn't actually tell you much about the overall strategy campaign, what's happening 5 miles away, the other side of the field, or what have you. So the danger is, and this applies both to radio, TV and print, is that when focusing on a particular incident, and this is particularly a problem in television, if you're focusing on a particular gun battle or mortar fire or what have you, it may look very dramatic, but it might actually not give viewers or listeners or readers a true picture of actually what's happening on a wider front.
And I think in technical terms, that's why they confuse the conflict arena with the conflict formation. The conflict arena is where the fighting takes place, and of course it should be reported. The conflict formation would take in all the actors, the players, as it's often said, who somehow play a role. Now, of course, if you were reporting, let us say, 2,000 years ago, or somewhat less than that, what happens in the Colosseum in Rome, you would be fascinated by gladiators, lions, and Christians, no doubt about that. But I think a good journalist would also ask questions about who make money. What's the power behind it? Why is it so important for them to kill these people? And that would give much, much more insight than the journalist who maybe even dresses up as a gladiator to get a feel for what it means.
The victims have been ignored. The people who are so-called collateral damage in Afghanistan have not had the coverage they deserved. The recovery that's now ongoing in Afghanistan has not been covered fully because it's deemed non-sexy. The starvation, the logistical problems and financial problems of actually feeding refugees has not had proper coverage. I was very, very surprised to read, I think in late January almost, a very good story written in The Guardian by a reporter who visited a food camp just outside Herat near the Iranian border. And people, you know, let's not forget, this is 2 months almost after the Taliban fell and the international effort arrived in Kabul. There were people dropping dead, a lot of people dropping dead in this food camp because they simply didn't have any food. These kind of things have not been given due coverage. And given the fact we are now talking about a serious war, a big, very big war now taking place in Iraq, you know, a full-scale invasion, in the knowledge that that'll be a very, very bloody battle, we're not learning the lessons of what happened in Afghanistan. We're not actually covering, picking up the pieces in Afghanistan, and yet here we are already planning the next one in Iraq.
Robert Fisk is a journalist who returns again and again to the site of the atrocities he's witnessed. At 10 o'clock on the morning of September 18, 1983, he was one of the first journalists to enter Shatila, a Palestinian refugee camp in Lebanon. A few days earlier, control over the camp had passed from Israel to a Christian militia. Thousands of Palestinians were massacred.
I go back there almost every year on the anniversary to write about it. I go back for two reasons. Firstly, because I think people should constantly be reminded of what happened. You know, there's a habit in history and journalism that each new horror is worse than the last horror. I don't think this should be an excuse for forgetting what happened at Sabra and Shatila. I tried to draw those camp massacres onto a different level, other than that which I saw on the day I walked in covered in flies with this dreadful stench. I also go back into the camps to talk to survivors whom I know and whose relatives I saw dead. And on one awful moment when I had to climb over a barricade, whom I walked on because they were dead. And I go back to keep asking them if they remembered anything they'd forgotten before. Last time I went there, I found a woman, for example, who suddenly said to me, "Thank God the Israelis were there because they stopped them killing my son as well." But the Israelis said they weren't in the camp at the time. So I'm trying to build up all the time a constant deeper picture of what actually happened, because I don't believe we know what happened.
Sometimes we actually criticize journalists, we call them like bleeding liberal heart journalists or what have you, if they get, some people say, too hung up on the civilian casualties. John Pilger is a case in point, who is very, very celebrated and hated at the same time for his work in Vietnam and elsewhere, because he sided with the victims of the war. Martha Geldhorn, James Cameron, other examples, people who actually are not transfixed by the military hardware, don't care about helicopters or going on operations or Patriot missiles or smart bombs or what have you.
In January 1945, Martha Gellhorn originally published this dispatch on the Battle of the Bulge. You can say the words death and destruction and they don't mean anything, but they are awful words when you are looking at what they mean. There were some German staff cars along the side of the road. They had not merely been hit by machine gun bullets. They had been mashed into the ground. There were half tracks and tanks literally wrenched apart, and a gun position directly hit by bombs. All around these lacerated or flattened objects of steel, there was the usual riffraff: papers, tin cans, cartridge belts, helmets, an odd shoe, clothing. There were also, ignored and completely inhuman, the hard frozen corpses of Germans. Then there was a clump of houses, burned and gutted, with only a few walls standing, and around them the enormous bloated bodies of cattle. The road passed through a curtain of pine forest and came out on a flat rolling snowfield. In this field, the sprawled or bunched bodies of Germans lay thick like some dark, shapeless vegetable.
There is a fixation sometimes, it seems, with some journalists, TV journalists especially, with the military hardware. You know, bang, bang, it looks good, whatever, and that's a problem.
Well, there's anti-aircraft gunfire going into the sky. We hear the sound of planes. They're coming over our hotel. However, we have not yet heard the sound of bombs landing, but there's tremendous lightning in the sky, lightning like a pig.
A lot of people go into journalism because they think it's an opportunity to have some power or to interview politicians or generals or leaders or what have you, or rock stars. But actually what a journalist should be doing, what a reporter should be doing, is reporting on and reflecting upon society, to be a communicator between government and the governed, and to actually go out and investigate stories, to go out and give voice to minority groups, disadvantaged groups, refugees, what have you.
The journalist has to get out of his two parties, good, bad, and Armageddon around the corner, the final battle, mindset, and just simply address a slightly more complex world and find ways of approaching it. People understand it immediately. I have more difficulties making journalists understand it than making people understand it, the reason being that journalists are much more socialized, brainwashed into a mindset, having an angle, who's the good one, who's the bad one, and maybe also how can we see to it that the good one wins.
How do you report peace while reporting conflict? Well, a lot of journalists will take issue with the idea that they should be promoting peace what they would agree with is that they have to promote or encourage understanding. And one way of doing that is by very carefully thinking about how they use words and how they use terminology, and actually being honest and actually saying when they don't understand or when they don't know, but not make assumptions. I mean, the funny thing is, and it's been said time and time again recently with regard to Afghanistan, is you would get correspondents outside Kabul when the Northern Alliance was pushing down towards Kabul, and they were standing out in the desert reporting back home for viewers, and actually before they actually came on air, they were being given information about what they should be saying from London, or Atlanta bureaus would be reading the wire copy from Pakistan or whatever, and it was simply being sent on the ground to these guys through the earpiece, and they would regurgitate what they heard. Because again, it goes back to the idea, if you're in the middle of a desert 50 miles outside of Kabul, you don't actually know too much. You can't actually see too much.
Focus on the conflict, find out what it is about, and focus on the solution. And that would mean, typically, to have extensive interviews with everybody concerned, all the parties, and they're usually much more than two. You see, we are dealing with a soccer field where there are 15 players, and they're playing different games, and the field is tilted, and the goals are shifting. And people are also changing color all the time, and they're changing their goals in all kinds of senses of that word. So it's a rather complex thing, but not at all impossible.
The role of a journalist in a conflict situation is to try and find out the truth. But then, in the end, what is the truth?
You've been listening to The Theatre, part of the Sound Fountain series, War of Words, produced and presented by Michelle Ernsting.
Thanks go to Norwegian peace activist Johan Galtung, Dutch professor Sees Hammeling, American media analyst Steve Rendall, media trainer Alan Davis, and journalist Robert Fisk.
The series continues next week with The Peace Room, talking with the enemy. This is a Radio Netherlands presentation.
Historian Howard Zinn has often said that the most important thing one ought to keep in mind when observing the conduct of politics is that governments lie. The U.S. government, under both Republican and Democratic administrations, has employed public relations firms to develop and fabricate lies designed to manipulate public opinion to support policies that they have already decided to pursue. Next, I'm going to read you an article published on November 12th in the Asia Times Online. It's titled, This War Brought to You by Rendon Group, and was written by Ian Urbina. Word got around the department that I was a good Arabic translator who did a great Saddam imitation, recalls the Harvard grad student. Eventually, someone phoned me, asking if I wanted to help change the course of Iraq policy. So twice a week, for $3,000 a month, the Iraqi student says, under condition of anonymity, that he took a taxi from his campus apartment to a Boston-area recording studio rented by the Rendon Group, a D.C.-based public relations firm with close ties to the U.S. government. His job, translate and dub spoofed Saddam Hussein speeches and tongue-in-cheek newscasts for broadcast throughout Iraq. I never got a straight answer on whether the Iraqi resistance, or the CIA, or policymakers on the Hill were actually the ones calling the shots, says the student. And that's how Baghdad's best-known opposition radio personality was born 6 years ago, during the Clinton administration. It was one of the many disinformation schemes cooked up by the Rendon Group, which has worked for both Democratic and Republican administrations fighting the PSYOP war in the Middle East. The point was to discredit Saddam, but the stuff was completely slapstick, the student says. We did skits where Saddam would get mixed up in his own lies, or where Saddam's son Qusay would stumble over his own delusions of grandeur. Transmissions were once a week from stations in northern Iraq and Kuwait. The only thing that was even remotely funny, says the student, were the mockeries of the Royal Guard and the government's clumsy attempts to deceive arms inspectors. The Saddam impersonator says he left Rendon not long ago out of frustration with what he calls the lack of expertise and oversight in the project. It was doubly frustrating, he says, because he despises Saddam, although he adds that he never has been involved with any political party or opposition group. No one in house spoke a word of Arabic, he says. They thought I was mocking Saddam, but for all they knew, I could have been lambasting the U.S. government. The scripts, he adds, were often ill-conceived. Who in Iraq is going to think it's funny to poke fun at Saddam's mustache, the student notes, when the vast majority of Iraqi men themselves have mustaches? There were other basic problems, too. Some of the announcers hired for the radio broadcasts, he says, were Egyptians and Jordanians, whose Arabic accents couldn't be understood by Iraqis. Friends in Baghdad said that the radio broadcasts were a complete mumble, the student says. One CIA agent familiar with the project calls the project's problem a lack of due diligence and adds that the, quote, scripts were put together by 23-year-olds with connections to the Democratic National Committee. Despite the fumbling naivete of some of its operations, the Rendon Group is no novice in the field. For decades, when U.S. bombs have dropped or foreign leaders have been felled, the public relations shop has been on the scene, just far enough to stay out of harm's way, but just close enough to keep the spin cycle going. As Franklin Foer reported in The New Republic during the campaign against Panama's Manuel Noriega in 1989, Rendon's command post sat downtown in a high-rise. In 1991, during the Gulf War, Rendon operatives hunkered down in Taif, Saudi Arabia, clocking billable hours on a Kuwaiti emir's dole. In Afghanistan, group founder John Rendon joined a 9:30 a.m. conference call every morning with top-level Pentagon officials to set the day's war message. Rendon operatives haven't missed a trip yet. Haiti, Kosovo, Zimbabwe, Colombia. The firm is tight-lipped, however, about its current projects. A spokesperson refuses to say whether Rendon is doing any work in preparation for the potential upcoming invasion of Iraq, but a current Rendon Arabic translator commented, "All I can say is that nothing has changed. The work is still an expensive waste of time, mostly with taxpayer funds." However, Rendon may just prove to be one step ahead of the game. If Saddam is toppled, a Rendon creation is standing by to try to take his place. The Iraqi National Congress, INC, a disparate coalition of Iraqi dissidents touted by the U.S. government as the best hope for an anti-Saddam coup, has gotten the go-ahead from U.S. officials to arm and train a military force for invasion. The INC is one of the few names you'll hear if reporters bother to press government officials on what would come after Saddam. At the helm of the INC is Ahmed Chalabi, a U.S.-trained mathematician who fled from Jordan in 1989 in the trunk of a car after the collapse of a bank he owned. He was subsequently charged and sentenced in absentia to 22 years in prison for embezzlement. Back home in Iraq, he's referred to by some as the so-called limousine insurgent and is said to hold little actual standing with the Iraqi public. Shuttling between London and D.C., Chalabi hasn't been in Iraq for years and draws more support on the Potomac than the Euphrates, says Iraq specialist Andrew Parasoliti of the Middle East Institute in Washington, D.C. Were it not for Rendon, a State Department official remarked, the Chalabi group wouldn't even be on the map. With funding first from the CIA throughout the 1990s and more recently from the Pentagon, Rendon managed the INC's every move, an INC spokesperson acknowledges, even choosing its name, coordinating its annual strategy conferences, and orchestrating its meetings with diplomatic heavy hitters such as James Baker and Brent Scowcroft. Not that the Rendon Group was the first purveyor of PSYOP tactics for promoting U.S. foreign policy in the region. In fact, some of the most impressive spin maneuvers and disinformation campaigns occurred during the Gulf War in 1991, the lessons of which are particularly pertinent as the U.S. gears up again. Most notorious was the work of PR giant Hill and Knowlton, for which current Pentagon spokesperson Tori Clark worked after she was an aide to John McCain and Bush's dad. Subsidized by the Kuwaiti royal family, H&K dedicated 119 executives in 12 offices across the country to the job of drumming up support within the United States for the 1991 war. It was an all-out grassroots blitz, distributing tens of thousands of Free Kuwait t-shirts and bumper stickers at colleges across the U.S., and setting up observances such as National Kuwait Day and National Student Information Day. H&K also mailed 200,000 copies of a book titled The Rape of Kuwait to American troops stationed in the Middle East. The firm also massaged reporters, arranging interviews with hand-picked Kuwaiti emissaries and dispatching reams of footage of burning wells and oil-slick birds washed ashore. But nothing quite compared to H&K's now infamous Baby Atrocities campaign. After convening a number of focus groups to try to figure out which buttons to press to make the public respond, H&K determined that presentations involving the mistreatment of infants, a tactic drawn straight from W.R. Hearst's playbook of the Spanish-American War, received the best reaction. So, on October 10, 1990, the Congressional Human Rights Caucus held a hearing on Capitol Hill at which H&K, in coordination with California Democrat Tom Lantos and Illinois Republican John Porter, introduced a 15-year-old Kuwaiti girl named Nayira. Purportedly to safeguard against Iraqi reprisals, Nayira's full name was not disclosed. Weeping and shaking, the girl described a horrifying scene in Kuwait City. "I volunteered at the Al-Adan Hospital," she testified. "While I was there, I saw the Iraqi soldiers come into the hospital with guns and go into the room where babies were in incubators. They took the babies out of the incubators, took the incubators, and left the babies on the cold floor to die." Allegedly, 312 infants were removed. The tale got wide circulation, even winding up on the floor of the United Nations Security Council. Before Congress gave the green light to go to war, seven of the main pro-war senators brought up the baby incubator allegations as a major component of their argument for passing the resolution to unleash the bombers. Ultimately, the motion for war passed by a narrow 5-vote margin. Only later was it discovered that the testimony was untrue. H&K had failed to reveal that Nayira was not only a member of the Kuwaiti royal family, but also that her father, Saud Nasir al-Sabah, was Kuwait's ambassador to the U.S. H&K had prepped Nayira in her presentation, according to Harper's publisher John R. MacArthur, in his book Second Front, Censorship and Propaganda in the Gulf War. Of the seven other witnesses who stepped to the podium that day, five had been prepped by H&K and had used false names. When human rights organizations investigated later, they could not find that Nayira had any connection to the hospital. Amnesty International, among those originally duped, eventually issued an embarrassing retraction. When asked if it acknowledges the incubator story as a deception, H&K's media liaison, Suzanne Laurita, only responded, quote, "The company has nothing to say on this matter," close quote. Pushed further on whether such deception was considered part of the public relations industry, she reiterated, quote, Please know that this falls into the realm that the agency has no wish to confirm, deny, or comment on." Close quote. Years later, Scowcroft, the national security advisor at the time, concluded that the tale was surely, quote, "useful in mobilizing public opinion," close quote. Agent K's baby atrocity routine really won over the hearts, but for the minds of real politics skeptics, the Pentagon had other methods. To sway them, the Pentagon flooded the major media outlets with reports of a top-secret satellite image that allegedly showed 250,000 Iraqi troops and 1,500 tanks amassed at the Saudi-Iraqi border. Once again, this was misinformation. When the U.S. military refused to hand the satellite image over to the press, several investigative journalists opted to purchase commercially available but equally detailed satellite images on the open market. Shots of the exact same region, during the same time frame, revealed no Iraqi soldiers anywhere near the border. The journalists hired a coterie of experts, including a former Defense Intelligence Agency analyst who specialized in desert warfare imagery, and the verdict was the same. No Iraqis, just desert, and a lot of U.S. jet fighters sitting wingtip to wingtip at nearby Saudi bases. But by the time those questions began circulating about the Pentagon's supposed satellite image and the web of decisions being spun around it, the U.S. military was already set on course. Once again, a similar mobilization is in high gear, with skeptical questions lagging behind. And that was "This War," brought to you by Rendon Group, written by Ian Urbina for the Asia Times Online of November 12, 2002.
If I made a list of everything I thought was wrong, it wouldn't fit in my fist, and I'm afraid it wouldn't fit in this song. And what would you do if I sent my long list of gripes to you? Would you throw them away, or would you save them up for that special day? Every couple of years we get the chance to participate in this pacifying dance. Hold your nose and vote. Now what if you got to choose which one of your hands you were gonna? What if you had a say in which one of your eyes you were gonna have to give away? Then you might start to see the level of hypocrisy in what they keep selling me as a two-party democracy, where every couple of years they give us the chance to participate in this pacifying dance. Hold your nose and vote, yeah. Hold your nose and vote, yeah. Keep that file down in your throat as you hold your nose and vote. Want parades? We got parades. We got parades all day. And if you want TV, we got more shows than you could ever bear to see. But if you want what's right, yeah, if your appetite is for what is just, then I'm afraid. participate in this pacifying dance. Hold your nose and vote, yeah. Hold your nose and vote, yeah. Keep that file down in your throat as you hold your nose and cast your vote.
Last Friday, during a mini-meeting of the World Trade Organization in Sydney, Australia, citizens took direct control of commercial radio there to remedy its refusal to provide meaningful coverage of citizen opposition to the WTO and its policies. A group calling itself the Institute for Applied Piracy jammed commercial radio signals for 10 minutes with a broadcast of an anti-WTO report. The media has not given any coverage to the real issues behind the WTO, said the radio pirates. It has only given sensationalist coverage of protesters being trampled by police horses and no explanation of why people are protesting. The media is neglecting its obligation to inform Australians about the issues important to their lives. We were unable to obtain an audio recording of this historic broadcast, but a transcript was provided by the Australian Independent Media Centre. Here's what the broadcast said. Good morning, Today FM. Welcome to a pirate radio broadcast on the day that selected members of the World Trade Organization are meeting in Homebush here in Sydney. As we speak, many thousands of protesters are flocking to the Olympic Stadium in Homebush, where today's WTO meeting is being held. So what is so bad about the WTO that people are prepared to risk becoming the victims of police violence and media vilification to protest against it? The reason people are so passionate about speaking out against the WTO is that the WTO makes decisions that affect the whole world. And yes, Sydney, this includes you. The World Trade Organization is an international body that exists to promote international free trade at any cost. It has no connection with the UN, and although its members are governments, they represent the wishes of corporations rather than ordinary citizens. In its own words, the WTO exists to eliminate what it defines as barriers to trade, but increasingly people around the world are finding that what is being removed is simply their basic rights. From human rights, workers' rights, and free speech to public health, education, and the environment, these issues are steamrolled by the WTO in the quest for profit. The thousands of concerned citizens heading to Homebush this morning are protesting against the WTO's valuing of profits over people. Now, it's easy to think that a group of high flyers making decisions about trade is a bit irrelevant to you. But actually, their decisions have impact on almost every aspect of your life, from your wages and conditions at work, to education, health, the food you eat, to indigenous issues and the environment. The fundamental difference between the WTO and other international bodies is that the WTO exists expressly to advocate the interests of business and does not represent the interests of citizens. The WTO sees issues of human rights, workers' rights, health and the environment simply as barriers to trade, and forces government to neglect these issues or suffer penalties. Under WTO law, it is illegal to give preference to a company just because they have good human rights or environmental practice. It is also illegal to discriminate against a company because they have a bad human rights record or cause environmental damage. With these laws, how can we prevent trade in endangered species or toxic waste? How can countries limit exports of food when there is a national famine, or of tree trunks when the forests are laid waste? How can we guard against human rights abuses and child labor in sweatshops? The WTO also penalizes countries in other ways. If our government urges us to buy Australian-made, it will be penalized by the WTO. If an impoverished country with a starving population tries to give financial assistance to its farmers to provide food for their own people, the WTO will penalize that government. In fact, policies that preference the use of local materials or labor are illegal under WTO laws. These rules of the WTO are unfair because they favor rich developed countries and have terrible impact on developing countries. For example, their laws promoting free trade allow floods of cheap imports to wipe out the livelihoods of small farmers. Maize prices received by poor Mexican farmers have halved since Mexico was forced to open its borders to cheap U.S. maize, causing havoc in the countryside. But even more unfair is that the richest countries break these rules under the WTO's blatant double standards. For example, the WTO has a law that makes governments reduce subsidies to farmers, yet loopholes in this law allow Western governments to increase the support to their own farmers. The United States forks out $20,000 per farmer per year in subsidies. The WTO encourages human rights abuses in its quest for free trade. It gives advantage to countries that break international labor and human rights rules. The WTO laws override existing national laws, deeming them all barriers to trade and sweeping aside all environmental, social, or public health considerations. WTO rules have had a devastating effect on world health in an effort to protect the profits of large drug companies. 7 million people in developing countries die every year from preventable diseases because the WTO prevents them from accessing basic medication. In Africa, 11 million people have died of AIDS, yet the WTO discourages them from buying cheaply produced generic life-saving drugs, insisting the rights of drug companies to protect their profits through patents is more important than saving lives. The WTO does not even allow countries to refuse to import a product that may be hazardous to the health or destructive to the environment unless they have undeniable scientific proof to the satisfaction of the WTO. Canada, the world's biggest asbestos producer, hopes to take advantage of this to force Europe to import the carcinogenic substance again. The rules passed by the World Trade Organization protecting patents mean that the world's indigenous people cannot use the medicines they have used for thousands of years and find they have to buy back their traditional knowledge from corporations. So if the WTO is so extreme, why don't ordinary people know more about it? The answer is that commercial media doesn't cover these issues. If people knew how their lives were affected by the WTO's decisions and how the interests of corporations overrode the needs of people, there would be a worldwide revolution. Commercial media is protecting its own profits by suppressing discussion about the WTO. We are prevented from taking part in the media, so now we're forced to shout over the top of it. And I was reading from a transcript of an historic broadcast that took place in Sydney, Australia on Friday during a meeting of WTO ministers. Pirate radio operators overrode commercial radio broadcasts for 10 minutes to present critical views of the World Trade Organization not being reported by the commercial media. Another world is possible, and we intend to make it real. Get something to write with if you can. Concrete steps are being taken in Ithaca next weekend at the first meeting of the Ithaca Social Forum. The Worldwide Social Forum movement is an effort to create direct democracy and citizen-controlled institutions in order to bypass and eventually replace formal governmental structures that have abandoned even the pretense of service to anything but the maximization of corporate profits and domination of the world by a wealthy few. Ithaca will be holding its first social forum, November 22nd through 23rd, at several venues in downtown Ithaca. Throughout the 2 days, forum participants aim to generate serious and urgent discussion about how we can effect change in these most alarming times, encourage citizen participation in community affairs, link local and global issues, facilitate networking between individuals and organizations committed to social change, connect issues of class, race, gender, and social exclusion, and discuss and develop concrete proposals for community improvement. Michael Albert, editor of Z Magazine and author of the recent book, Trajectory of Change, Activist Strategies for Social Transformation, will be with us throughout the 2 days. He will be delivering 2 speeches, the first on Friday, November 22nd, at 7:30 p.m. His topic will be Another World is Possible, Alternative Economic Visions. This event will be held at the First Presbyterian Church in downtown Ithaca and is free. He will speak again on Saturday afternoon on a different topic, from anti-war activism to social justice. That talk will begin at 5 p.m. at the Unitarian Church in downtown Ithaca and is free. A variety of workshops will also be held on Saturday morning downtown at the First Baptist Church. For more information, contact Lucas Shapiro at lucas_shapiro@hotmail.com. You're tuned to WEOS Geneva, WXXE Fenner Syracuse, W201CD Ithaca Community Radio at 88.1 FM, or Free Radio Santa Cruz. This is on Welcome Guests. Media in the 1980s used to refer to President Ronald Reagan as the Great Communicator, I suppose because he successfully sold a presidential persona and a particular ideology by expertly delivering well-crafted speeches written by others. The speeches employed the use of glittering generalities to recast pecuniary motives as a mythic battle between good and evil. Themes from the then-hit movie Star Wars were heavily used. Among the rhetorical phrases was that featuring the Soviet Union as the evil empire. This interesting phrase suggests that a benevolent empire might exist. What is an empire but a nation that forcibly brings other peoples under its control in order to increase its wealth and land? Where's the benevolence? Now, instead of a single evil empire, we are presented with an axis of evil. The same people that stage-managed the Reagan-Bush presidency are in control now, trotting out the same time-worn manipulations given new life by the September 11th attacks. As Peace Studies founder Johann Galtung described in part one of the documentary series on propaganda that we've been playing for you, the selling of war to populations hinges on the framing of international relations as a conflict between good guys and bad guys. The rulers of every aggressor nation in recorded history that I am aware of justified their wish to make war to their own populace by presenting the nation or group to be attacked as posing some threat. One well-used tool in the arsenal of war propaganda is racialism, the portrayal of those to be attacked as some less-than-human species. Once so perceived, they can no longer have a point of view that ought to be considered. The talk we're about to hear by Dr. Michael Parenti is titled Rambo and the Swarthy Hordes. Michael Parenti is an author and political analyst. Among his books are The Sword and the Dollar, Inventing Reality, History is Mystery, and his latest, The Terrorism Trap. This talk was given in 1989 in North Hollywood, California, during the administration of George Bush I, an administration consisting of most of the same players that occupy positions in the present Bush administration. In the talk, Parenti looks at the entertainment media as a propaganda vehicle for American ruling class interests and attitudes. With the recent spate of war movies and TV shows glorifying the CIA, FBI, and police, this 13-year-old talk is eerily relevant. Control of media is even more concentrated now than 13 years ago, as most major media outlets are subsidiaries of massive corporations with interests in a variety of areas, including armaments. At the time this talk was given, Saddam Hussein was a great friend of the United States, and Osama bin Laden was, in the words of the great communicator Ronald Reagan, the moral equivalent of America's founding fathers.
I want to today give attention to the other side of the media, not the news media, but the entertainment media, because the entertainment media consumes a much larger share of the viewing time of most Americans than do the news programs. And I thought I would call this book something like The Hidden Political Images of the Entertainment Media. And then as I thought about it, I said, well, what's so hidden about it? It's rather blatant. And what I looked at are Hollywood films. That's what I'm studying. Hollywood films and TV dramas, TV miniseries, teleplays, and the like. What I find is a real abundance of images and ideologies, ones that are essentially supportive of imperialism, anti-communism, capitalism, racism, sexism, militarism, say militarism twice, militarism, authoritarian violence, vigilantism, and anti-working class attitudes. More specifically, I found these kinds of themes. Individual heroics predominate over collective action. There's almost no collective action. There's almost no story or drama where the people organize together and do something for themselves. I mean, there are one or two exceptions. When they do, when there is collective action, they're usually led by some hero who has to spur them on and really do the whole thing himself. Free enterprise is the best economic system in the world. That's a message which is not necessarily telegraphed so much as it is presumed. Certainly, there's nothing positive ever uttered about alternative systems in the entertainment media. Private monetary gain is a central and worthy objective of life, although those who are too wickedly greedy, the Dynasty guys and Dallas fellows, they can meet with disapproval. Sometimes business characters are insensitive to other people's needs because they're so busy with their business activities, but when properly apprised of the problems and such, they are suddenly capable of legendary acts of generosity, which I've never seen in real life, but I see on television dramas say, the kid needs the house, give it to him. They give him to give it to, I'll give the factory to Joe, he's a good guy, and all that sort of thing. Workers are beer guzzling, regular Joes, I mean, good-natured and all that, but really not very bright, incapable. If I was to say any one consistent stereotype I've seen about how blue-collar people are portrayed in the media, with the exception of certain films, by the way, everything I say, there are a few notable exceptions. With the exception of a film like Silkwood or A Matter of Sex, or a few others, they're almost always incapable of leadership and of acting as agents of their own lives. One wonders really where labor unions came from. Labor unions are always up to not much good. They're rather insensitive to the needs of workers. Some years back, there was a TV program, Archie Bunker, All in the Family, which was supposedly against various forms of bigotry. And while it came out against the bigot, who was Archie Bunker, and made a little message statement against bigotry, every program practiced a bigotry of its own by portraying the working person as this goof and goon, and one of the big laugh lines in All in the Family was when Archie Bunker mispronounced a word, committed a malapropism, and the canned laughter would come on. That's not funny. There's nothing funny when somebody mispronounces a word. I mean, all you're saying is that he hasn't had the opportunity to have the education that some other people have had. But class bigotry is a very common form of bigotry, and it remains totally unchallenged, unlike gender bigotry or race bigotry, which at least is challenged today. The practices and forms of class bigotry go on in abundance in the media and remain unchallenged. Affluent professionals in almost all programs are considered much more interesting than blue-collar or ordinary service workers. There are many more of them as principal characters. Women and ethnic minorities are really not as capable, effective, or interesting as white males. Cop shows, the police and everyone else should be given a freer hand in combating the large criminal element in America, using generous applications of force and violence without too much attention to constitutional rights. In fact, in any number of cop shows, the cop will get up and talk about that Constitution isn't going to protect you, it's only me with my gun and the hell with the Constitution. The ills of society are caused by individual malfactors and not by anything in the socioeconomic system. No, no, no. There are some unworthy persons in our established institutions, but they are eventually dealt with and set straight for the most part. U.S. military force is directed only toward laudable goals, or more often the goals are not even stated. It's just assumed that we've got to win this one. Nothing said about what kind of interests are involved. I mean, after all, why are people doing all this fighting and killing? It's a question that remains largely unstated. Western industrial and military might, especially the U.S.'s, has been a civilizing force for the benefit of backward peoples throughout the Third World. The United States and the entire Western world have long been threatened from abroad by foreign aggressors, such as the Russians, communist terrorists, Arab terrorists, and generally the swarthy hordes of less developed peoples. Those are, I would say, some of the general themes that come up again and again in any number of movies. And the last one is the one I want to focus on today. It's the paradigm of the wagon train versus the swarthy hordes, first enunciated very well by in a marvelous article by Tom Engelhardt in the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists. It could be happening in the American Wild West. It could be in the Amazon jungle, the North African desert, the Sudan, the Transvaal, the South Pacific jungles, or Indochina. The scene is generally the same. There's a fort, or an encampment, or a wagon train. And inside that encampment are the human beings. They're white. They're human. They're warm, they're attractive, they talk, and they're nice. Outside come the swarthy hordes, the savages. They can be Indians, they could be Bushmen, they can be Arabs on camels and horses or whatever else. And they are the subhumans, and they are attacking the human beings. And the wagons form their circle, and the human beings know what to do. They level their guns, and they begin to knock off, shoot, and kill these screaming savages who attack them. Why do the swarthy hordes attack the white people? You don't know. They never tell you. Is it to protect their lands? Is it to protect their herds? Is it to protect their villages and their towns and their families and their children? No, it's just because they like to do that. That's their thing. They like to attack. And so they have to be killed. And by the way, it's not even bravery that they manifest as they charge in great numbers and get cut down in horrible numbers. This is not even bravery, although similar acts by whites would be portrayed as heroic. This itself is portrayed as a manifestation of the swarthy hordes, their fanatic, crazed way of wanting to bloodlust. Now, the trouble with this paradigm is that it turns the history of the last 400 years on its head. That it reverses the roles of usurper and usurped. It reverses the roles of victim and victimizer. It reverses the roles of those who were massacred and those who were doing the massacring. It was the European and North American civilizers, so-called, who went in there and destroyed the villages and destroyed their industries and destroyed their townships. Read Engels on North Africa, what happened to the Arabs and Berbers, and when he goes in and describes the beautiful towns with the fine, hard stone and plaster buildings and their woolen industries and their mining industries and their arts and crafts and all that. And then read the description of the French troops coming in and systematically destroying it and killing every man, woman, and child. Read about how the Germans went into South Africa and killed the Herero tribe. 80,000 people, they killed 60,000 of them, and the other 20,000 they used as slave labor in their minds. Read Mark Twain's angry, raging comments about King Leopold of Belgium, calling him a mad dog and what he did to the innocent, unoffending people of the Congo, taking them and enslaving them, 1 million of them a year dying in the mines in the Congo. That's what the history's about. That's what John Wayne is about. And what these films do is they reverse that history, stand it on its head. They do what Joseph Goebbels said. They give you a big lie, and they embellish it, and they make you root for the guys in the wagon train. Now, once you kill and once you plunder like that, once you go in to take another people's land and steal their labor and enslave their labor and take their resources and preempt and take over their markets, once you do that kind of act, and it wasn't the ordinary people of Europe and North America that did it, it was the ruling interest that did it, and they used our taxes, our money, and our sons to go fight. But once you do that, you have to do two other things ideologically and psychologically. One, you have to deny the humanity of your victims. They are subhumans and they are moral inferiors. As John Wayne said in one of his horse operas in 1953, he said, "There's humans and then there's Comanches." A very clear message. He couldn't have said it better. There's humans and then there's Comanches. You're not killing human beings. You're killing these wild animals. By the way, you can get the same quotes from Winston Churchill about the Afghanis. You can get the same quotes from George Washington about American Indians. And you can get them from any number of imperialists. The second thing you do is you must ascribe all your crimes to them. You deny your own inhumanity and you accuse your victims of doing to you what you have been doing to them all along. Sometimes imperialism can take on an endearing, tender note, though. I found one movie which I want to share with you. It was with little, cutesy, adorable Shirley Temple. She was in the movie called, ready for this, Wee Willie Winkie, 1937. And she asked her grandfather, who's the British colonel, they're off their way out in some place where the British have no business being, and she says, "Why are you mad at Khoda Khan, leader of the, quote, warlike tribes?" The British colonel answers tenderly, "Oh, darling, we're not mad at Khoda Khan. England wants to be friends with all her peoples. But if we don't shoot him, he'll shoot us." This is sort of the Pat Buchanan, Cap Weinberger approach to foreign policy. Now, another interesting thing, these defamatory stereotypes and images demonstrate the unholy marriage between imperialism and racism. Marx has a very fascinating quote. I've got it in The Sword and the Dollar. Of British officers in the Sepoy Rebellion in India. It was a contemporary account. The officers said, "We hanged every nigger we found." In India, they're talking about India. Use the term nigger. "We hanged every nigger we found." I mean, every Indian they came across, they hanged them. The suppression was horrible. In South Africa, the people are called Kaffirs. In the Middle East, ragheads. In Asia, slopes and gooks. Well, these terms, nigger, Kaffir, slopes, gooks, this is a vocabulary of imperialism as well as a vocabulary of racism. And indeed, I'm not going to argue that imperialism is the cause of racism, but certainly imperialism is one of the biggest instigators and propagators of it. You have to finally define whole categories of people as different and inferior to justify what you're doing. Even when the imperialism is not of the violent sort, and even when the racism is not evident, it still can permeate a film sort of implicitly. Take the case of how Hollywood has dealt with Africa. The Tarzan movies, I won't even say a word. There, it's so evident and so obvious. We'll just say the Tarzan movies. Okay, I've proven my case. But let's go on. Let's go on beyond Tarzan, and let's take a more modern-day effort, finally. Finally, Hollywood, finally, in the 1980s, in the last 30 years, I've been waiting for an intelligent movie about Africa. There's 1,000 stories in Africa. There are stories of tribal conflicts, of generational conflicts, of urbanization, of cultural change, of labor struggle, horrendous, incredible level of labor struggle like nothing you see in North America, like nothing you see in Europe. 250,000 gold miners out on strike together, and they don't have computers and carpools and all that sort of thing. Incredible amount of discipline and organization and courage from a people who supposedly are not ready for self-government. 1,000 stories, 1,000 dramas that you can make. And so Hollywood finally makes a movie about Africa, and it's called Out of Africa. And what's it about? It's about an upper-crust Danish literati whose major concern, it seems, is to hang on to her plantation and get it together with her beautiful blonde boyfriend, Robert Redford. That's what the story was about, played by Meryl Streep. And the Africans in Out of Africa, I kept looking for the Africans. And there they were, sort of around the edges, saying things like, "Is Sahib happy? Does Sahib want dinner now? May I do this for Sahib?" Addressing her reverently. And then Robert Redford comes along and he sets her straight, because he's kind of gone native a little, you know, and he says, "I want to show you my Africa, the real Africa." I said, "Hey, here it comes, the breakthrough. And what does he do? He takes her up in the plane, and you see those same old aerial shots straight out of the Tarzan flicks of the zebra herds and the giraffes running along. Still no Africans. And I said, ah, oh, this is why they named it Out of Africa, because there's nothing in Africa about it. Then finally we got to a really good film, and I do mean it, Gandhi, which at least portrayed Indian principles and showed the Indians acting with courage together, although it all came from the magic leadership of Mohandas Gandhi, apparently, and it even showed some of the brutality of the British. But even that film, I would have to make a serious criticism, because it gets to the heart of the political economy of the entertainment media, and that is that the political economy of imperialism was never shown in that otherwise fine film. The forced underdevelopment and impoverishment of India by British capitalism was never shown. The fact that when the British went into India between 1830 and 1900, the per capita earnings of the Indians dropped by two-thirds. That India was pillaged. That poverty was not an original condition of India. India is a lush, fertile subcontinent. The poverty of India is a direct cause of the policies of British imperialism, which was to forcibly deindustrialize India. That could have been dealt with in some way. You know, you could say, well, you know, I mean, what do you want, Parenti? How can you do that in a film? I mean, you can't start reading tracts of Lenin in the middle of a film or chapter 3 from The Sword and the Dollar. You know, you just can't do that. But during the course of a movie, you can have some discussion, some word explaining what are the British doing in India. I sat for 3.5 hours through that film, and they never explain why are the British in India? What are they doing there? And you're left with the impression that they're in India simply because they like to strut about with their swagger sticks, and they simply don't have the decency to go home when asked to go home. But in fact, very powerful British interests got very rich off the land, the labor, the resources, and the markets of India. A film that really deals in an uncompromising way, and in a very good way, it's not a particularly well-made film, but the script and the political content of it is terrific, was made in 1969. It deals with imperialism, the political economy of imperialism, too, and that was called Burn, an Italian-French production. It's nice to hear applause from the 7 people who were able to see that movie, because the distribution of that movie was remarkable. I mean, it actually dealt with the class interest behind it, dealt with the transition from slavery to free labor. You had Marlon Brando explaining why it'd be better, it would have less costs and all that sort of thing. This movie was suppressed in its distribution. It was taken out of circulation. It did not reach many theaters, and it did not stay long in the ones it did reach. And it would make a nice little story as to what happened to the distribution of that movie. There's another area where the wagon train paradigm exists, and that's right in the urban frontier. It's what Hal Himmelstein in his book on television calls the urban frontier. It's the fort, the wagon train, the encampment all over again, but it's in the middle of the city. Again, you've got the human beings, and they are under siege, and they are under siege again from swarthy hordes. There are plenty of TV shows, as you know, and plenty of movies. Let me just give you one called Cobra by Sylvester Stallone, who wrote it and acted in it. The comedian Jay Leno was right. Stars like Arnold Schwarzenegger and Sylvester Stallone deserve a lot of credit for opening up the acting profession to a lot of people who could not get into it back when speech was a requirement. Cobra is, and by the way, this has been a standard character over the last 20 years, in the last 15 years or so, in films and TV series. He's a whacked out Vietnam vet, bitter, wounded, angry that he couldn't win it. He wanted to win it, and you didn't let him win it. So now he's a detective in New York, and he fights the whole gang, and they are trying to terrorize and take over the city or the country or the world. It's not clear. And so it's cowboy versus Indians, cowboy singular, cowboy versus Indians. And Colebrooke goes out there, and again, the same thing, makes his talks about you pussyfooting with the Constitution and all these rights, and I'm going to do it my way, and I'll really take care of them. And Colebrooke doesn't believe in sissy things like arrest, trial, and incarceration. He just executes these guys. He just murders people, and one of the gang guys he captures, he douses him with gasoline, and then he lights a match. As he sets fire to the guy, he sneeringly says, "You have the right to remain silent." Now, the most durable version of the swarthy hordes, that external alien menace that's going to come at us, is the red tide and the red menace. You can defeat the Indians and the Bushmen, but communism is still around there, and it will subvert us from within, or it will inundate us from without. You remember Ronald Reagan's speech about Nicaragua? If we don't stop them in Nicaragua, the red tide will be lapping at our borders. That Nicaragua is only 12 hours drive from Brownsville, Texas. That's if you drive 180 miles an hour, but whatever. Well, that basic paradigm, that image, is being propagated by our presidents, our political leaders. And in the 1980s, the Reaganite cinema reached new heights of anti-communism, and Soviet bashing reached new depths, I should say. Rambo 2 with Sylvester Stallone. In Rambo 2, Stallone, he not only acts, if you want to call it that, acts in these roles, he also writes the scripts. And he turns around in that movie and he says to his old Green Beret commander, he says, "Are we going to fight to win it this time?" And he certainly does win it. He goes into Vietnam and he kills a battalion of Russians. He kills the whole Vietnamese army. They throw napalm at him. He's captured by them. He's tortured. And he liberates prisoners of war. He's aided by the fact that his adversaries all seem to be legally blind. They cannot shoot straight. Hundreds of rounds are shot at him and they just always miss. Never fluff his hair. But while the movie is outrageous and it's ridiculous, again, don't lose sight of the fact that it's once more turning history on its head. I mean, in reality, the Vietnamese have exchanged prisoners of war with the United States after signing the Paris Peace Agreement, which ended the war. And that whole POW-MIA issue is really an outrageous pandering exploitation of the unrealistic hopes of those families, conducted by the Pentagon and the U.S. government and played upon by people like Ronald Reagan. You know, there are 18,000 Americans missing in action from World War II. Where do you suppose they are? Are they being held captive in Toyota factories or in beer cellars in Wiesbaden someplace or something? No, tragically, unfortunately, sadly, they're dead, and it's acknowledged that they're dead. But the 2,000-some missing from Vietnam have never been acknowledged realistically for what they are, which is that they're dead. Instead, that issue is exploited. It's not only exploited, but whole movies are made out of it. Not just Rambo 2, but Missing in Action 1, Missing in Action 2, Missing in Action 3, Bradford, Missing in Action 4, I think, is coming up soon. Second, U.S. prisoners of war were not tortured by the Soviets in Vietnam, as depicted in this film. They have Rambo being tortured by Russians. There is no historical record of that. There is, however, a record of South Vietnamese-trained forces and U.S. special forces using all sorts of torture, electric shock, water treatment tortures on National Liberation Force fighters. Third, the Soviets did not drop napalm on anyone in Vietnam. You know who dropped the napalm in Vietnam. Just complete turning around. The U.S. dropped huge amounts of napalm and Agent Orange, something like 20% of the land. The whole food chain in Vietnam has been tainted. Vietnam was a country that had no liver cancer. It was an unknown disease because people ate sensible food like rice and grains and vegetables. And today it has one of the highest rates of liver cancer in the world because of what we did to their ecology chain. That's not what you get in the film. I guess you can get that kind of lying from somebody like Sylvester Stallone. If he could portray himself as a fearless war hero, even though he spent the Vietnam era working at a private girls' school in Europe, why would we expect him to play straight with the larger history, right? Rambo 3, Rambo is in Afghanistan now. And the Soviets are portrayed as sadists, rapists, and torturers who murder little children with explosive toys, a horror story that originated, propagated by the CIA, for which there's no evidence. The Red Army has got better things to do than put toys down to blow up kids' fingers. For fun, good old Rambo sends a Soviet captive plummeting. He takes him, puts a noose around his neck, and he throws him off a cave shaft down to his death. And then for still more fun, Rambo dynamites him. Blows him up. He had him rigged up, and he sets him off. What a guy, that Rambo. He gets along real swell with the Mujahideen killers, the feudal landowners, the Islamic fanatics, and the opium growers, the guys who took up guns when the Kabul government said that their women could take the veils off, and their women could go to school, and their children could go to school. They took up guns, laughably described as the Afghan freedom fighters. Those of you who supported them, I hope you continue to support and watch how they operate and what they stand for. Let me say that Rambo gets along real well with them. By the end of this third and worst of the Rambo films, our hero has sort of mellowed out a little. He gives his good luck charm to an adoring 12-year-old Afghan boy soldier who himself is shown killing Russians on several occasions. War is a kind of a healing, nurturing experience for Rambo. You know, in Rambo 1, which I didn't mention, he was a borderline psychotic. He got into all sorts of trouble. He was a Vietnam veteran who was just psyched and freaked out. By the end of Rambo 3, all this violence has kind of put him together. He's found himself. As the movie ends, you feel he's going to move on, maybe head back to the States, buy a trailer, hunt bear, settle down maybe, you know, get married, open up the nicest little gun shop in Texas. Get married, I don't know about get married, because women don't figure in the Rambo movies. In fact, most of these violence adventure movies, women just really, literally don't figure, of course, as except for the bed scene or sex objects. They are just attachments, accessories to the heroes. I mean, literally attachments. They're usually attached, being yanked along by the hero as they're in heels and dress, as they're running from some danger. Women have an uncanny ability to get themselves into dangerous situations for which they are extricated by their men. If they do handle a gun occasionally, it's ever so gingerly to just sort of shoot and keep their feminism. Usually they just stand there helplessly while the hero fights off a platoon of attackers. This is what women are for in Rambo movies. Movies like Red Dawn, Invasion USA, and television series like America, I think, represent the crudest propaganda of the Reaganite cinema of the 1980s. They show the Soviets, assisted by the Nicaraguans and the Cubans and the Libyans, invading and attacking the United States and killing and massacring U.S. citizens. Again, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, you know, history is stood on its head. The Soviets have never invaded the U.S. I have to kind of remind my students of that once in a while. But the U.S. has invaded Soviet Russia, well, along with 14 other nations, 1919 to 1921. They moved in and took them over. But that isn't what you see in Red Dawn. In Red Dawn, the Soviets, they have a nuclear attack on Washington, D.C. They wipe out Washington, D.C. because they are having troubles with their crop. They have crop failures and they're having famines. So they decide to take it out on Washington, D.C. And they come down and they invade and take over the heartland of America. And they're rounding up people and they're massacring them. Also in Red Dawn, Cuba and Nicaragua have emerged as leading powers in the Western Hemisphere. And these Spanish-speaking soldiers are machine-gunning all these Americans. I mean, it's just horrible. But luckily, in a little town in Colorado, a group of high school students escape. And they break into a sporting goods store, and they get out all these rifles, and they go up into the hills. Spend the rest of the movie wiping out these whole convoys of Russians. I mean, just wiping them out. I mean, you start feeling sorry for the Russians. They're just getting wiped out by these kids with the rifles who call themselves the Wolverines. In Invasion USA, that was even more fascinating. A secret expeditionary force lands in Miami. Can you imagine landing secretly in Miami on a bright moonlit night? Hundreds of Russians And Spanish-speaking, Spanish-looking guys, who we can assume are Cubans and Nicas, and Arab-looking fellas, who we can assume are PLOs and Libyans, maybe. And they're all actually quite a good little international force they had there. They land about 20 yards from the Montembleu, you know, totally unimpeded, undetected. And I'm sitting there saying, who could do this fanning out, getting to trucks? They aren't drug smugglers. I mean, they couldn't just... And they fan out and they infiltrate up the coast and they start committing acts of terror which turn neighbor against neighbor and neighbors against the police and the police against the neighbors, and nobody knows what's going on. Nobody can understand how this is happening. Nobody can understand what the danger is, what it is they're confronting. Nobody except Chuck Norris, who who rallies, single-handedly rallies some troops and wipes them out and saves America. Well, the Russians have never invaded the United States. I tell my students the United States has invaded Russia, and they say, what? What? What movie was that? What? The Nicaraguans have never invaded the United States. While that film was being produced and made and distributed and viewed, the United States was invading Nicaragua for the 9th time in our history. 7 of those times before there ever was a Soviet Union. The Cubans have never invaded the United States, but the United States has invaded Cuba in 1961 and has encircled Cuba and has oppressed that economy and done everything it could to destabilize that country with embargo, with political oppositions, with acts of sabotage. The Libyans have never attacked the United States, but the U.S. has attacked and threatened and harassed Libya on several occasions. That's what the movies ought to be about. And Gaddafi's sin is not that he's a terrorist. Gaddafi's sin is that he took a country that had a social structure like Saudi Arabia, and in the Colonel's Rebellion of whatever year it was, 1965, thank you, what they did was they took over the land. They reclaimed and confiscated the oil. They confiscated the property of the rich. They kicked them out. They instituted changes. They set up a reclamations program. They've planted 40 million trees in Libya. They've put in a public education program for every man, woman, and child. Women can now go to school. Women can even go to military academy. Gaddafi's real sin is that he's distributed income, that the Libyans have the highest per capita income and standard of living in the Arab world, and Gaddafi's real sin is that he's an anti-imperialist. And so what they do is make movies showing Gaddafi-like Arab terrorists terrorizing and victimizing you to stir up in us hatred and fear of these people. Well, you can say, well, you know, that's the way it is with the masses. Luckily, I'm not affected by that stuff. Well, Jeffrey Schrank did a very interesting study in one of his books. He pointed out that 90% of all TV viewers think that we are not affected by advertisements. He also pointed out that the same 90% buys roughly 90% of the products that are advertised on television. And while we might think it is always other people being manipulated by these images and these sales appeals and these shows, the truth might be something else. Another investigator, Jerry Mander, in Mander's book, The Case Against TV, he argues that the media images are in a certain way irresistible, in the sense that our brains absorb them regardless of how we may consciously regard such images. So you may consciously be watching this thing and saying, isn't this ridiculous, isn't this something? But these images are going into your head. They're going into the other side, while this side of the brain is saying, isn't that awful? This side is absorbing it. Children, for instance, if you want to see how it works, look at children. You've got to carefully talk to a child and convince the kid that this isn't real life, that don't worry, that didn't happen. They really don't have an innate capacity to distinguish between real and unreal images. Only as they grow older, after repeated assurances from their elders, they begin to understand that the stories and the characters on the big screen or the little screen really don't exist in real life. In other words, their ability to reject media images as unreal has to be learned. It's a learned ability. Their innate predisposition is to accept those images as real. Now, Mandar argues further. He says the problem doesn't stop there. Even as adults, when we consciously know that a particular movie, TV is fictional, we still, quote, believe it to some extent. That is, we accumulate these impressions, and these impressions lead to beliefs about the real world. Our unconscious mind does not distinguish between the images we got from real experience and the images we got from a secondary environment like movies and TV. The mind doesn't work that way. Listen to what the African-American writer Ellen Hawley has to say. I want to quote her at length because it's worth it. The way we are perceived by this society affects the most basic areas of our lives. When you apply for a job, the interviewer in personnel reacts to you not only in terms of who you are, but also in terms of who he thinks you are. There are countless images floating around in his head, and many of them are traceable to the media. You may sit in front of him as a neatly dressed, intelligent female who would do an efficient job, but if he's been fed one stereotype too many, he may look and see not you, but Flip Wilson's Geraldine goofing on the job, painting her fingernails, and calling up a boyfriend to chat on company time. If so, for all your qualifications, you're not the one who's going to get the job. Black teenage unemployment runs as high as 40% in some of the more deprived communities. I don't think it helps black teenagers get hired that the television box portrays them to the nation and to potential employers almost exclusively as vicious little hoods ready to rip off anything in sight, or as goof-offs and clowns. Again and again, I have seen black actors turned down for parts because they were told that they did not look the way a black person should or sound the way a black person should. What is this business of should? What kind of a box are we being put into? I have seen black writers told that the black characters they write about were not believable because they were too intelligent. Well, look, we're giving the people what they want, the argument goes. This is a popular culture. Let me make two arguments to that. One, the polls show otherwise. They show that, in fact, people are watching more television but enjoying it less. That substantially high percentages say they think it stinks. Most people at best say that TV is either not very interesting or mildly interesting. Only a small percentage think it's really terrific and they really find it great. It's called popular culture. In fact, most of it is done for sponsors, and most of these producers really go on the hunches they have, what they talk to their colleagues and their neighbors and all that sort of thing. And it's not popular culture. Popular is an adjective for the populace, meaning the people, something that comes from the people. This media culture doesn't come from the people. It's not a people's culture. If anything, the mass media have undermined, preempted popular culture. The folk arts are gone, folk crafts are in decline, community recreation, community forms of interaction. When people talk, often they talk about not their experiences, but about TV experiences and celebrity characters. The image environment is a highly fabricated, controlled one. It's dominated by multi-billion dollar multinational corporations. They are the ones who produce and fabricate and feed this culture to us. They not only have a preeminent influence over the quality of the food we eat, the air we breathe, the water we drink, but also now the forms of recreation that are available and even the very images we put in our heads. It's argued that demand creates supply. We're giving the people what they want. If they didn't demand this, they wouldn't get it. The people want it, so we give it to them. But quite often, as you know, it's supply that creates demand. People watch what's on television because that's the only thing that's on television. They go to junk movies because that's what the movies are. Rambo 3 opened up in 2,175 movie theaters in America. That's supply right there. That's giving you a whole hype that's going on for weeks before it opens up. That's getting people activated to get them to come see this movie, which, by the way, was a flop. It was a box office flop. Burn opened up in about 40 movie theaters around the country and didn't last very long. So you could say people don't want to see Burn. They want to see Rambo. No, people aren't given a chance to see Burn. They might have found it very interesting. They might have found it very intriguing. What I'm saying, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, is that capitalism is not only an economic order, it's a social and cultural order. It extends its influences into all of our life activities. You've heard about the movement to take back the night. Take back the night. Women talking about the right to walk safely on the streets at night. A very good movement. We also need a movement to take back our sight. We need to take back our culture, our institutions, the fruits of our labor, the intelligence and development of our children, the control of our own mental images, our own recreational and free time. We need to organize. We need to agitate against the garbage we're being fed. We need to support things like KPFK Pacifica and FAIR. We need to boycott these major media. We need to denounce them. We need to openly attack them and pressure them and organize against them. We've gotten rid of Step and Fetch It. We got rid of Amos and Andy. We got rid of Sambo. Let's get rid of Rambo now. These media are not totally immune to the political climate of opinion, and we can change that climate. The media do respond to some degree, even in only a limited way. George Bush introduced the empty metaphor of 1,000 points of light. People are still trying to figure out what the hell he meant by that. So is George Bush. But there are, ladies and gentlemen, there are 1,000 points of light, the very points of light that Bush is trying to douse. And that's the people awakening. Bush said in his State of the Union message, said people are still suffering from the Vietnam syndrome. Well, the Vietnam syndrome was people raising questions about the war. And then they began to raise questions about the leaders who produced this war. And then they began to raise questions about the system that produced the leaders. And so it is today. People are catching wise to imperialism. And one of the greatest bulwarks against direct U.S. intervention is the fact that U.S. public opinion prohibits it and will not go for it. The people are organizing and demanding a better deal at home and abroad. 1,000 points of light have become 10,000, 100,000, 1,000,000, 10,000,000, all over this world, all over the world you can think of, from Palestine to Central America, to Asia, to Africa, to Southern Africa, people are struggling. And right here in the U.S. itself, right in front of the Pentagon, people are struggling. The struggle for democracy goes on. Don't ever be discouraged. No Sylvester Stallone or Chuck Norris can turn that around, nor can their more fictitious counterparts, Ronald Reagan and George Bush, turn it around. None of them will be able to stop the people's struggle to reclaim their own history, a history that is being made right now, every day, by us. Thank you very much.
We have just 10 minutes for questions, so if you will come to the microphones, and we'll start over here.
Thank you, Michael. You didn't mention the film Cry Freedom, which was universally attacked by the syndicated critics because it was not about Steve Biko. Was it blackballed because it didn't go far enough or because it went too far?
I had long discussions with people about Cry Freedom, and I came to the conclusion that, yeah, there was that racial bias. In fact, I mentioned it in the book I'm writing now, that there are blacks in South Africa getting tortured, and you just see that peripherally. The white family is put under house arrest, and you're in the house with them, shown from the perspective of this white family. Maybe you got to do that to reach white audiences and get them to see palpably how this kind of system oppresses black people and even those whites who might have a conscience about good and evil. That movie didn't get a mass distribution because movies of that kind simply will not get that kind of distribution.
I tend to feel that the blue collars have a certain liking for this racist wagon train mentality that you've described, even though you apparently feel they do not. And also, they don't seem to object to the degrading, demeaning portrayal of themselves on TV as much as we would hope. Could you speak to those two questions briefly?
Well, I think blue-collar people object to the demeaning and patronizing portrayal of themselves if alerted to it. There was a study done by the International Association of Machinists, a content analysis of television systematically done, and it was done by machinists who were at home at night and their families, of how working-class people are portrayed in the media. It's a terrific study. It has been totally and completely ignored by the news media. When Wimpen Singer reported and held a press conference, it was non-news, showing how they're under portrayed, how work is never shown, how the struggles of working class people are never shown, how it's reduced to real crappy stereotypes. So these people were aware, if given the opportunity to study this. The Teamsters Union even sent out a formal protest. United Auto Workers also sent out a formal protest against the Archie Bunker stereotype. Working people are not Archie Bunkers, and we resent this. At least the labor unions have, to some degree, done that. But you're right that often people are victimized if those are the images they get, and they're taught to laugh on cue at this and all that sort of thing, that many people will accept it uncritically. That is true.
I always have trouble with the paradox between whether it's really a degeneration of people's tastes or whether there really is some kind of pressure going on to keep the little gems that do get through. There are gems out there. Like, for example, John Carpenter's They Live that came out last year, and Terry Gilliam's Brazil. And it's amazing. You realize these people do have a tremendous audience. The Monty Python audience is tremendous. John Carpenter's audience, just for his horror films, is tremendous. And yet these gems come out by them, and they're not seen. I can't figure it out. But really, is it really... a conspiracy to suppress
yes.
the films?
Yes, 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 God damn yes. it, yes. What do you think they're doing? What do you think these guys do? What do you think they get? Why do you think they're paid $400,000, $500,000 a year to do? They are the gate guarders. And when they get Bertolucci, who is the hottest ticket in international filmmaking, to make a film, and he comes up with a film like 1900, which is a communist film, which shows these Italian workers singing the Internationale, facing up to the fascists, joining the party, fighting fascism, and they were the only ones who did, shows the big rich landowners collaborating with the fascists. You know what they did with that film? That film was slated for mass distribution. It had Burt Lancaster in it. It had all sorts of big Hollywood name people in it. Sterling Hayden and others. It was supposed to go into every shopping mall. When they saw what that film was about, bam, that was it. It went to about 10 art theaters in America. There were whole areas where you couldn't see it. When John Sayles does a movie like Meituan, right. he couldn't get one studio, not one studio to support it. Because it was telling the truth about what the class nature of class struggle in this country is. It was telling the truth how they'll kill you. They'll kill you if you try to cut into their profits. They'll kill you if you try to have a decent wage for yourself and for your family. And he made that movie, had to do it independently. And I've been to parts of the country where people have never heard of Meituan. I'm talking about people who are interested in political films. Just talking to Bob Caruso, University of Southern California, Northridge. He said, Meituan, what are you talking about? What? No, it never showed around here. Never saw it. In Northridge, that was. The guy's a film buff. I've been to other parts of the country. It played strong in New York. It played for a while in Washington, D.C. It opened in Chicago, a couple other places. But there's a different kind of distribution. It's not the mass distribution. It doesn't go into hundreds and hundreds of theaters. So they do control distribution. But they don't control production that well. Capitalism will sell you a camera and a film and a computer. You can write these things and you can produce them. It's distribution. They control distribution. And yes, they consciously do not like certain things. Look at the Albanian travel posters they had up for Reds. I mean, just a week before it came out, there was this poster of this guy. I mean, it looked like an Albanian travel poster. I mean, Reds got almost no publicity. I mean, that was a remarkable film. By the way, that was a remarkable breakthrough because Beatty got an Academy Award for it. But again, they cooled that one. They cooled the distribution. I think there's a lot of examples, but you're absolutely right. I didn't go into that. There are a lot of good films, too, and I do talk about them in my book because it's important to talk about how do you do it right. What is your example of what would be a good film? I think the ones that are the best are those that come closest to historical truth. That becomes the criterion. Yeah.
In the Things We Can Do department, a comment when Rambo is peaking, a group of veterans in San Francisco called the Veteran Speakers Alliance organized educational pickets by Vietnam veterans of the film Rambo. We did that around San Francisco. We sent action packets around the country. It was front page news. Caralco, who is promoting the film, called up to ask, what's your problem with it? They even suggested a debate with Sylvester Stallone, which they later, of course, changed their minds on having.
That would be fascinating.
Stallone.
That would be the greatest cultural event of the year, a debate with Sylvester Stallone. How would you do it? How would you do that?
Go ahead. But Within a month after these pickets appeared around the country, the film Rambo 2 was withdrawn from movie theaters and simply went into cable distribution.
That's good. And can I point out also the political action that went around the TV series America, that there were a lot of people who did a lot of good political work against that. Here was at a time when the hope was there was going to be some kind of arms agreement or some kind of way of de-escalating this overheated Cold War, and people really explicitly fought that and fought it well.
So I wanted to suggest that a lot of veterans now are going into high schools, because if you go to a Rambo film, it's almost all adolescent teenage boys that are seeing it. And one thing that people can do is to find out if recruiters are in the high schools to, you know, neutralize some of the BS that are given to them by recruiters and by the makers of Rambo films.
Could you go into deeper how they control distribution and how they suppress the distribution of the 1969 Italian...
The movie 1900?
The Burn film.
I don't know. That's a story I still would like someone to come up with. I haven't researched it. Or I can tell you my own personal experience with Burn. I was living in Burlington, Vermont, and it opened on Thursday. And the new film always comes in on a Thursday. It goes from Thursday to the following Wednesday. And it opened on Thursday. I said, Burn, oh, I want to see that. I really want to see that film. And I went on Friday, and it was gone. It was closed. The manager had pulled the film off. Now, that's from only one place. But I later heard in other places that it didn't run a week, or it never came, or a poster would be up, it's coming, but then it never appeared. That was the more common thing, that it was supposed to come, but then it doesn't come. Some of the suppression is carried out by the media, by the gatekeeper critics. Conservative critics like Gary Arnold, for years in the Washington Post, reduced the cinema in Washington, D.C. to imbecile stuff. The guy was a conservative, really. Any film that had any feminist values in it, any anti-military values, any political content of any kind, he would just pan it, rip it apart. And he would always say, plot unresolved, characters weak. Well, I mean, quality films, too, like Gaijin. You ever see that one, the Brazilian-Japanese film about the workers in Brazil? You didn't see it. Ah, you didn't see it. It was a great film that should have opened in 2,000 theaters. It was a story about Brazilian, Japanese, and Italian workers in Brazil in the early part of the century, and how they'd been brought in, immigrant workers, and the struggles they went through and what happened there. He just ripped that apart. It lasted a few days. All my friends say, oh, that's a lousy film. I'm not going to go see it. I said, go see it. Go see it. So quite often in your media, your back pages are more rigorously controlled even than your front pages. That was true of Time magazine. Henry Luce used to check out the back pages and make sure which books were going to get reviewed, which movies, how, what was going to be said about them. They know very well that that's popular, that that's reaching millions of people, and they want to be clear as to what images you get and don't get. And there are ideological controls as to who becomes a movie critic and who doesn't in the mainstream. Media might make a nice edition of Extra, or at least a story in Extra, about who reviews these movies and why and how and what kind of things they like and don't like. Thank you very much.
You've been listening to Rambo and the Swarthy Hordes, a talk by Dr. Michael Parenti given in 1989 during the first Bush presidency. For more information on Michael Parenti's writings, you can visit his website at www.michaelparenti.org.
If you have an event you'd like us to announce or an issue you'd like us to cover on the program, you can contact us at our website at www.radioforall.org/unwelcome. That's radio, the number 4, ALL.org/unwelcome. Our theme music, Unwelcome Guest, is performed by Billy Bragg and Wilco, with lyrics by Woody Guthrie. Unwelcome Guests is produced by Chris Sturr, Jesse Lind, Lynn Gary, and Sean Ewald. We are solely responsible for its content.
Then I'll be gone, but that won't be my end. For my guns and my saddle.